Hi, I'm Commander Rebecca Waddington, the current Acting Chief of the Operations Branch at NOAA's Aircraft Operations Center. I'm also an aircraft commander on NOAA's Gulfstream 4, which you see behind me, also known as Gonzo. This is a very unique aircraft. It is normally a business jet, but has been reconfigured to do specialized high-altitude atmospheric research missions. It is the only aircraft of its type to be specifically tasked with hurricane surveillance flights. Now, let me tell you a little bit about this plane. The reason we call it Gonzo is because of its elongated nose. The nose is different than any other G4 nose because we have a much stronger radar, a weather radar, inside, and that's used for hurricane research. Now, if you follow me to the back of the aircraft, you can see one of our other specially configured parts of this Gulfstream 4. It's called a TDR, which stands for Tail Doppler Radar. We have a similar radar on our P3s. This is a radar that's attached to the tail of the aircraft, hence the name, and it gets a very strong vertical profile of the storm. This helps as we fly in and around convection to really determine the profile and how strong each convective tower is. And you can see it right there sticking out the back of the aircraft. Now, the rest of the Gulfstream 4 looks very similar to any other business jet, but inside it's got a completely different picture. Let's take a look. The interior of NOAA's Gulfstream 4 is configured for science instead of luxury. So we actually have 10 seats and 6 different research racks, as you can see right here. The back of the aircraft, where we are now, is kind of the bread and butter for our research missions. This is a drop sonde station. A drop sonde is an instrument that we deploy from the aircraft. Looks like this. It's about the size, a little bigger than a Pringles can. We deploy it from the aircraft through this drop sonde chute right here. So the way it works, we open that up, put the drop sonde in, and then close it back up and release it. It's released because of a differential in atmospheric pressure. So outside, when we're flying at 45,000 feet, the air is very, very thin. But inside the cockpit, it only feels like we're at 6,600 feet. So that difference in pressure will literally suck the drop sonde out of the aircraft. Once it deploys, it unravels this drag chute. This drag chute helps keep the drop sonde going straight down through the atmosphere rather than tumbling end over end. The entire time it's going down, it's collecting different different data for meteorological research. So it's getting temperature, humidity, wind speed, wind direction, and atmospheric pressure. This helps us better to understand what the atmosphere is doing and how it's going to impact the hurricane. We always have 2 drop sondes ready at any given drop sonde waypoint in case one fails. That data is vital for the atmospheric model, so we want to make sure that we get good data every time. As we walk towards the front of the aircraft, you can see some of our other scientific research stations on board the G4. Coming up here, you have our tail Doppler radar stations. This is where we have a meteorologist and a technician looking over the radar data that's being collected by the TDR, so we're getting that vertical profile of the storm. And then the very front 2 stations are where our meteorologists sit. These are our flight director stations. Over here on this side, you can see this little gray box is actually a repeater of our nose radar. So the pilots have one sweep of the radar that we can use for the safety of navigation so that we can fly in safe locations. And our meteorologist back here has a second sweep of the radar where they're looking at it from a scientific perspective as well as a safety perspective. Our pilots are in constant communication with the person in this seat, the flight director, so that we can fly into safe areas and keep the crew safe as we're flying in and around a hurricane. Let's go to my favorite spot in the plane, the cockpit. Welcome to the flight station of the Gulfstream 4. This is by far my favorite place to work. And if you look around here, you can see that we have a lot of switches, a lot of circuit breakers. There's a lot going on up here at all times. Whenever we fly, we have at least 2 pilots. The pilot flying sits here in the left seat where I am, and the pilot monitoring and working the radios is in the right seat. On nighttime hurricane flights, we actually bring an additional 3rd pilot just to help with the circadian rhythm change, and an extra set of eyes is never a bad thing. So this plane is very sophisticated. As I mentioned before, we can fly up to 45,000 feet in altitude, and our max speed is Mach 0.88. Our usual mission is flown at Mach 0.77, which equates to about 450 miles an hour. Being able to fly high and fly fast allows this jet to cover a large amount of airspace. So when we're talking about hurricane flights, we actually fly in front of the storm and around the storm itself. The data that we're collecting in front of the storm
helps us determine how that atmosphere is going to impact the track of the hurricane. So it's very important for the hurricane forecasters to get that information. When preparing to go fly a hurricane mission flight on the Gulfstream 4, preparation actually begins the day before the flight. We are tasked either by the National Hurricane Center, the Environmental Modeling Center, or the Hurricane Research Division. When NHC or EMC tasks us, they're really looking at how we can improve the forecast for that particular storm. When we get tasked by HRD, they're looking at more of a long-range improvement for all of forecast. So they're really more focused on the research side of things. Depending on who tasks us, the missions can be quite different. I want to show you an example of a tasking by the National Hurricane Center. Again, this is a tasking that's more focused on that particular storm at hand. So this is one of our missions for Hurricane Dorian. The National Hurricane Center sent us this flight plan. Once they send that to us, our pilots take a look at it, and we're first looking for any kind of safety concerns. One of the big things we look at is this inner ring here. That's where we're going to get closest to the eye wall of the storm, and so it's our most dangerous aspect of the mission. One of the things that we've decided during our pre-season operational risk management meetings is that we will always fly that inner ring in a clockwise direction. That keeps us from getting trapped into convective valleys within the storm. So sometimes when we get these taskings, we'll look at it and it will actually be labeled in a counterclockwise direction. At that point, our pilots are in constant communication with the National Hurricane Center and will adjust the flight track to meet our safety expectations. Once that is set, we'll take the flight plan and we will run it through our long-range planning tool. Most of our missions are about 8 hours in length, and of course, they're limited by the amount of fuel that we could put on the aircraft, which for the G4 is 29,500 pounds, so it's quite a bit. We run this through our flight planning tool, and from that we could tell if we're going to be able to complete all of the drop points. Each drop point is labeled by these little circles, or if we're going to need to drop some of them just because of fuel and the range. At that point, we'll go back with the Hurricane Center and make recommendations. They also have particular points that maybe aren't as important as others when they're trying to get the data for the storm. Now for the research missions, those flight patterns can be very different. This is an example of Hurricane Lorenzo last year, which was located way out in the eastern Atlantic. We actually deployed from Barbados and had a transit for over an hour just to get to the storm environment. This particular path is in a star pattern, and that's used primarily when the Hurricane Research Division is interested in the data that we can get from our tailed Doppler radar. Every time we go into the storm and turn around, we get a very nice picture from the radar of what the storm actually looks like. So once we have the flight paths and we run them through our flight planning tools, we'll then continue doing other routine mission work, updating our weight and balance for the aircraft, checking NOTAMs, looking at different areas on our flight path to see if we might encounter any airspace that could give us issues with air traffic control. This one, being way down in the Atlantic, didn't have any issues, but with Hurricane Dorian, our flight path takes us fairly close to the coast of the US, and this is an area of high traffic with aircraft transiting from the northern states down to Florida. So we have to do a lot more coordination for these kind of flight paths and working with air traffic control and alerting them that we're going to be dropping weather instruments, those drop zones, out of the aircraft. When we're in flight, we're constantly looking at our TCAS, our traffic collision avoidance system, looking at it below us to make sure that there are no aircraft directly beneath us when we make those drops. We certainly don't want to drop those weather instruments on another aircraft. Prior to going out to the plane, one of the last things we do is have a weather briefing. Our flight meteorologists get us all together in the room and they talk about the storm, any hazards we might encounter within the storm environment itself, or on the way to and from the storm. Hazards such as turbulence, icing, lightning, deep convection. And again, these paths are based on a forecast position of the storm. Since we get them the day before, the Hurricane Center is actually basing these patterns on where they think the storm is going to be, which isn't always where it actually is once we get out to the storm. So in our pre-flight weather briefing, our flight meteorologist will let us know if the storm has slowed down, if it's sped up, so that we have an idea prior to even getting in the plane on how we're going to need to deviate around certain convection. So in the plane, we have a left seat pilot, and that is considered the pilot flying, a right seat pilot, which is considered the pilot monitoring, and then, of course, our meteorologists, engineers, and technicians in the back of the aircraft. Communication within the plane is constant. We're always talking to each other as pilots up in the cockpit and also talking with our meteorologists or our flight director in the back of the aircraft. Each one of us is monitoring the radar, making sure that we're staying safe. So the person in the right seat, the pilot in the right seat, is also in charge of the radio. So we're not only talking to air traffic control, but we're also talking to our flight meteorologists, and they will let us know if they think that we're going to need to deviate around any deep convection.